Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this Link and Learn edition dedicated to the disruption in the banking industry. Our agenda today will be split into three main items. I will start with a short introduction on what are the main disruptive forces in the banking industry now. And then Esther Bauer, manager in our strategy practice, will discuss how PSD2 is impacting the industry and what is the impact with the open banking wave. Then Gwenael, director in our operational excellence practice, will explain us why we need to look at process optimization in a different way, thanks to robotics. And finally, I will close with some explanation and some statistics on how AI is reshaping the industry today. So just have a few issues to skip the slides. So if we look at the industry today, we of course have different financial and political trends. But aside of that, we have four major trends. The first one is the change in the customer behavior. The second is the pressure that we have on cost-income ratio, mainly linked to technology and new entrants. The third one is the pace of change of technology. And finally, the fourth one is open banking. If we look at first the customer behavior, today we can say that customer wants consistency, customization, collaboration, also convenience, control, and convergence of the on the channel and devices. And I want to make a focus maybe on two of those topics. The first is convenience. It's clear that today the customer wants to have access to the banking relationship manager or to their banking services anytime, anywhere. And it's very easy to say, but when we know how the banks are organized internally, I mean how the incumbent banks are often organized internally, it's a hell of a challenge, because we all know that the legacy IT platforms have significant unavailability times. We also know that call centers have several constraints. So clearly, that convenience requirement has a significant impact. The second expectation that is also strongly impacting is the consistency across channels. We have seen over the last year the multiplication of channels, and having a consistency of information, a consistency of tone, is also very complicated to achieve. If we do a focus on the evolution of the channels, until a recent past, the branch was clearly the main channel. It was used to do all the transactions, and it was also used to perform all the sales. We had some services activity through mail and phone, but that was quite limited. And in some countries, the ATM was also playing an important role in the transactions. In other countries, especially in Asia, we have seen the development of the ATM into VTM, virtual teller machines, that were able to perform very advanced transactions and even account opening. But that is really specific to some countries. If we look today, banks have performed several projects to transfer operations, mainly from the physical channel to the digital channel. And so the role of the branch decreased in terms of transaction intensity. And we saw also the internet banking taking more and more importance in that in the relationship between the bank and the customer. And today, we also have the mobile channel. Mobile channel currently, it depends a bit on the country, but it's mainly used to perform transactions. And in some countries, it starts to be a sales channel, but it's really the beginning. And in the near future, we expect that the mobile channel will become a very important sales channel, mainly for simple products like consumer loans or some asset transactions. And internet will be almost at the same level. Branch will stay with a different importance, of course. We'll focus on advice, we'll focus on sales of complex products, but clearly the objective is to remove all the transactions from that channel, just because of cost, of course. So we see that the roles of the channels are evolving, constantly evolving, and that we need to tackle the consistency channel, the consistency challenge across all those channels. Now, looking at the second trend, which is the cost-to-income ratio. We have performed a survey across many countries in Europe to look at what are the cost ratio of traditional banks and digital banks. And what we saw is that, on average, incumbents are around 70%. When we look at cost-income ratio of digital banks, they are around 35%. Of course, it's just impossible for incumbents to go that way, but they are challenged against that benchmark. And so they are clearly looking at how digital banks are achieving those results, and they are trying to implement the same kind of technology to reach those objectives. Speaking about technology, each decade, if you look at the past 50 years, brought its wave of technology. It was first about the mainframe, then we saw the personal computer, increased collaboration, engagement technologies. Recently, it was the digital wave, and today we are talking about the exponentials. What changed, really, is the pace. So every year, the pace of the new technology has changed, and the number of technology change also quite rapidly. So the challenge for banks today is how to navigate within a very complex landscape of technology, and how to deal with the pace of apparition of those technologies. And we will discuss that in a minute. And finally, last trend is open banking. Esther will discuss that much more in a minute. But what we see is that we have two drivers, in fact, for that trend. We have a technology driver, because the open banking concept is based on APIs, and that's technology. But we have also a regulatory driver. And the second directive on payment services is clearly a strong trigger for that open banking, let's say, ecosystem or open banking world. And that trend is reshaping the way banks are building value proposition, but also the way they are looking at their own business model. So, bottom line, we have, aside of the political and economical trends, we have four main trends that are really challenging banks and pushing them to look at the business model. And today we will focus on two of those trends, technology, of course, with artificial intelligence and robotics. But first, the open banking. I will now leave the floor to Esther to develop further that trend.
Thank you, Ronan. So before we start talking about open banking, let's actually get us quickly started with the second payment services directive. This directive is very often also referred to as PSD2, and this will be the term that we'll be using throughout this presentation. PSD2 was introduced by the European Union in 2015 with a number of objectives, which are very strongly linked to a relatively quickly evolution of payments that has been happening in the past few years, and a number of challenges and opportunities that have come from this. Payments have always evolved pretty quickly since the beginning of mankind, actually starting with payments of simple barter in early history to the evolution towards gold-backed money or credit cards in more recent times. But the rising importance of technology and digital channels has actually accelerated this evolution a lot faster than it was before. And in the past, I'd say 20 years, we've actually seen two very groundbreaking changes that have happened, as we've had more and more online payments and mobile payments emerging, which are changing the way that banking and consumers are interacting today. And these accelerated changes have actually resulted in a number of challenges for the regulators to which the European Commission wanted to respond in creating this payment services directive. So one thing that we can actually see, and this is the first objective that you will see on the slide, is that new payments actually create new risks as well. And in the same way that regulators used to have to protect consumers and banks and merchants from thievery and robbery through, for example, policemen, nowadays we also have to protect them from similar threats in a digital environment. And it is for that reason, actually, that consumer protection and security are one of the key objectives that the European Commission wanted to have in order to respond to these changes in the payment landscape. A second element was that in recent years we've seen significant innovation and improvement, but there's still a long way to go. So the European Commission actually wants to drive further improvements in payment services across Europe by actually encouraging innovative companies to be able to interact in the payment services market. And this is really the third and the most commonly known objective of the PSD2, which actually was to provide a level playing field for the competition. So previously we had quite strong entry barriers for non-banking actors that were inhibiting some new entrants to enter this market. And with PSD2, we're actually introducing a new type of actor that will bring a breath of fresh air to the payments market. But the PSD2 is actually not the first regulation that's been looking at payments. We've had before the first Payment Services Directive, which looked at the same area, but there were quite a few limitations, and PSD2 actually tries to go beyond what PSD1 had, which was actually by introducing, for example, new actors, which we'll look at in a little bit more detail in a second, but also extending the scope of PSD2 to actually include payments which only have one leg in, or one leg out, on the other hand, and actually also forcing banks to open their interface to third-party actors. So I suggest that we look at a bit more detail the provisions that PSD2 has. Firstly, this new directive actually introduces a number of new requirements in terms of compliance, which are very strongly linked to consumer protection different indemnity insurance and reporting obligations. The second one is a new requirement, as I mentioned, is actually that the scope of transactions will be expanded to include payments where one part of the payment might not be in the EU. But we're not going to focus on these two requirements in too much detail, as their help towards, or their influence in moving towards open banking is more limited. We'll much rather focus on the bottom two elements, which are actually the introduction of new stakeholders. So there will be two new types of stakeholders who are third-party payment providers that will become regulated as a part of the Payment Services Directive. These payment services providers that will become regulated, there's two types. We firstly have the AISP. So AISP stands for Account Information Service Providers. These are actors that actually are able to aggregate information on customer payments accounts. What does this mean exactly? Well, you can imagine that you might have a bank account in Luxembourg, another one in Germany, and again another one in France. An AISP will be able to actually go and take information from each one of these bank accounts and aggregate them in one single place so that you can actually see them in this place. The second new type of payment provider that will be introduced is the PISP. The PISP stands for Payment Initiation Service Provider. These type of actors can actually initiate payments on behalf of the payers, on behalf of the payer towards the payee. So if we take again our example, we can actually imagine that the actor aggregating the accounts is also a PISP. As a PISP, this fintech will be able to initiate a payment from any of my three accounts towards another account. And the second provision, which is very, very important for open banking, is that banks will actually be asked to provide information on accounts to these new actors. So these requirements are addressed in various places of the directive. For example, there's a few articles on this. But they will ask a bank to tell an AISP, for example, recent transactions or the balance of the payments account. And by providing these new actors with this type of access, customers will actually no longer really need to have a direct interface with banks to view account information or initiate a payment. Much rather, actually, these customers can solicit the services of, for example, fintechs or commercial companies to actually see their bank account and initiate payments. So on the next slide, we'll actually see how this creates a situation of open banking. On the left side, you'll see a typical closed banking scenario as we might have it today, or maybe not today, but earlier, before today. So here we can see that the customer actually interacts mainly with the bank, who has access to all of the customer's client, product, and bank data, and there's no other person in this relation. On the right, by the contrast, we actually see an open banking scenario. And we can see that here, actually, the number of actors that are involved become much larger. And we see that while the customer can still interact as previously directly with their bank, they also actually have the choice to interact rather with someone else. So, for example, a price comparison website or a third-party provider. And if we take the example of the third-party provider, which can show information to the customer as well as initiate payments, we're creating the risk for banks, actually, that the customer might prefer to interact mainly with the fintech rather than with the bank, leading to a real risk of disintermediation. And so open banking here really represents a shift in paradigm from today's world, because today banks are really treating their products, services, and data is proprietary, while in the world of tomorrow, where we have an open banking world, we'll really see these products and services and all of the data shared for the use of third parties that will aim to create products with benefits for customers and to create really a world where third parties become the main interface between customers and banks. And if we move to the next slide, we can actually see why this is the case. In front of you, this is just an example. You will see a few screens that represent personal finance management. Personal finance management is just one area in which fintechs are active, but it illustrates really well how new actors actually allow customers to have a very, very different experience of banking to what traditional banks used to provide. In this case, for example, we can see that fintechs provide customers with a fun and really personalized banking experience. For example, we can see a screen in the middle, the third screen from the left, where we see a monster which is fed with cookies that are money to encourage customers to save money. Or on the left of that screen, we see the pictures that show what the actual savings goal is. And when we see these kind of screens, we do ask ourselves, why would a customer want to have a more traditional, boring experience when he can make something such as banking really fun? And as I said, this is not the only area. Actually, we have fintechs in all kinds of different areas that are providing value to the customer in a way that banks can't. If we take the example of Cabbage, for example, which is a U.S. startup, this company still provides small businesses with really, really fast loans. And this is based on a number of very basic criteria. And in terms of speed, Cabbage is able to provide customers with a loan in a speed that a traditional bank will not be able to do. And this is, again, the question arises, why would a customer not want this kind of experience? But this doesn't mean that all hope is lost for banks, because banks are actually very open to, or can very well work together with these fintechs and other companies and developers to create value to the customer and take advantage of this new environment in which they're acting. If banks are able to change their business models from closed models towards more open models, models that embrace collaboration with other actors, they'll actually be able to deliver very new value to their customers and be much more competitive compared to more traditional actors who are still closed. And I mean, when we look at what's happening in the market today, we can see this happening as more and more banks are working together with PMFM fintechs or in other areas as well, like loans. So there's a real opportunity here, but the banks also need to take into account that there are a number of risks and challenges that are associated with turning towards this open banking model. As we see new actors entering in collaborations with banks, we see that it's really important to ensure that there's a robust governance that takes into account all different types of operating models, and we need to be sure that security and risk are very carefully managed. With these changes, we also have the need for appropriate human resources, the adaptation of skills, and this is a real opportunity for banks, but it's not necessarily very easy at the beginning, and it really requires banks to completely embrace this new paradigm. And with this short conclusion, I would like to stop here for today, as time is limited, and I'd like to hand over to Gwen.
Well, thank you, Esther. So now I'm going to transition to a completely different type of challenge. So we've just seen here that banks are actually under pressure already because they see their business model being challenged by the regulation, and they need to create new offerings, create new type of models, create some governance, such as Esther pointed out. And that means that they need to be really careful also on the money they spend. So when Ronan made his introduction, he just mentioned that the cost-income ratio of banks are just being also put under pressure, so meaning that for every single euro that a bank collects, they need to make sure that they spend as little as possible. So we've seen that traditional banks at the moment have on average a 70% cost-income ratio, meaning that for each euro they collect, they're spending 70 cents, when digital banks that we see now appearing have 35, so they spend only 35 cents for collecting the same euro. So how can banks actually improve this, and how can they work on reducing their costs so that the customers only receive value and only pay for what is really something that they think is valuable? Well, one of the solutions, I'm not saying that this is the only one, but one of the solutions could be robotics. So when we talk about robotics, so of course everyone has in mind some droids that can actually move, like in Star Wars. Of course, we're not talking about this kind of mechanical robots. We're talking about softwares. So you have to think about robots as being macros, as you can see them in Excel, but just imagine that this macro can actually go outside of Excel. It can go on the internet. It can go in any user application, so any graphical user interface that the systems of the bank can have. It can be a mainframe, it can be a website, it can be anything. It just needs to have an interface. The good thing about that is that also then the robots will be forced to follow exactly the same rules and the same checkpoints that a regular user could have. And normally to set up this kind of software, we have to create a user for that robot. So it really, in terms of systems, interacts as a human being, except that it's a coded software behind, hence the name of robot. Okay, so it's really doing anything a human can do. Now, what can we use them for? Well, basically, if we're talking about RPA, and we'll see that in the next slide even better, robots are really following rules. So as long as we're talking about robotics, we're not talking yet about artificial intelligence, and this is actually something that we'll touch on right after this section. So robots are really following a tree of decision. So you have to imagine that they have in their mind, if then, so if I have this, I do this, and that's it. If not, then I take the other rule and the other rule and the other rule until I fall out of options, and then I ask a human being to take over. So that may sound limited, but it already opens a huge array of activities. such as, for example, validating any data, collecting things, moving data from one way to another. So, for example, we've seen some banks using robots to actually create some online forms that they had and they were collecting on their website, and actually it was going to an employee who was retyping everything in the mainframe, because at least the information was structured, but there was no interface directly built between the website and the mainframe. Well, a robot can easily do that by just simply following rules, and it saves some precious time for others. It can also make some calculation, it can make some computation of several data into a report. It can send simple information when a job is complete, or just collect some information. So you see you have a huge array of activities that can be handled by robots, and we'll see some more concrete examples in the minutes to come. So when you think, and that's the last part of this slide to the right, when you think about what a robot can do, what type of process you could ask a robot to work on, well, it has to be rule-based. It has to be, of course, repetitive, because you have to teach the robot how to follow a process. If the process is changing each day or each occurrence, you then need to teach the robot each time, and then that's the same as doing it with a human. It needs to be based on structured data. The robot cannot improvise. It has to follow some templates. You need to have some kind of volume, and it's best if you use the robots on processes that are usually prone to human error, because the robots will follow the rules and will not make mistakes. So I just briefly touched in the previous slide on the fact that robots, at least RPA, so robotic process automation, we don't have any intelligence. Well, there is actually some intermediate step between what we have as simple task given to robotics, which is RPA, that already give us a lot of opportunities. And to the far right, what we really have seen in movies, such as A Space Odyssey with HAL 9000, which is the pure human similar type of intelligence, so really where you have a pure artificial intelligence. This is still science fiction, but there's a huge array in between. So today we're focusing on this green square, so robotics, but you have to know that there are already some solutions that come and then start to also have some judgments and some machine learning capability. And then you have also some augmented intelligence, such as you can see in your iPhone or with a software such as Watson from IBM. So today we're focusing on that one, at least in this section, but it also already gives us the ability to increase speed, to increase volumes, to reduce errors, and also save costs. So, what can be the benefits of implementing a robotic process automation project? Well, first of all, robots can operate 24/7. So, as long as the system of the banks are up and running, well, the robot can work. It can be during night, at night, it can be during the weekends, it can be at any time, as long as you're not running batches, of course, then the robot needs to log off. But this is already seriously improving your ability to have a workforce at your disposal. Of course, it can reduce costs by automating tasks and by reallocating the resources that were previously doing those tasks to some more added value task. It run much faster, of course, than a human once it follows the different rules that you've been setting up. It increases quality because you're not doing errors, and it allows your employees to focus on added value, which also is something that can be well appreciated by your employees, so the bank employees. Usually, typical projects of RPA really have a very short payback period, which usually have less than a year. So if you take into consideration the license cost of a robot, the time that you spend analyzing the processes, coding them, testing them, deploying them in production, and maintaining them, you take all those costs and you see what it saves you, you usually have a payback period less than a year. You can increase, of course, your scalability, and it's also usually well appreciated by the internal controls activities. Most of the times when we come to clients, so to banks, we have the compliance officer or the auditor that are a bit scared that they will have something, a beast unleashed in their systems in production. Well, actually, everything that the robot is doing is logged. But whenever the robot is using a password, the first thing it does, it changes the password to something that only the robot knows, so that no one can actually steal the identity of the robot. So it's quite well secured and well under control. So this is more recap of applications that you can give to a robot. I'm not going to go through all seven skills that you have listed here, but I'm just going to take a few examples. For example, you see that a robot can gather and collate and validate information. We've had a project recently where a bank was actually using robots to collect some information to put some reports in place. There were several reports that were populated by their clients on websites, and then they needed to have someone screening the website, identifying who had updated to what, uploaded documents, collect them, run through some checks, make sure that the documents were okay, and then input the content of the file into the system. All that could be done by a robot, and that could save some valuable time. Robots can also, on the point two, transport information and data. I already told you that I've seen an implementation of a robot for connecting a website to a mainframe. Well, currently also, I've seen some applications of robots where you can migrate data from an old system to a new system, and rather than using some traditional scripting, extraction, transforming, and loading, you can actually use robots to do the transformation, the transportation of data from one system to another. We've also seen, for example, on the seventh point, sixth point on monitoring, we've seen some banks actually using robots to go on the different competition websites and collect data and compare their pricing instructions to compare to what the competition was doing. And if the pricing was changing or any information was changing, then there was a short email that was sent to warn that this given competitor had changed its information on the website. So you can also use robotics to do some activities that you would normally not have time to do. So going back to what a good process, a good candidate for automation would be, you have those five points that you have here at the top of this slide. So you need to look for processes that take a lot of people and a lot of time from your employees. You need, and this is usually where this is the key, if you have multiple systems involved into one single process, this is really where the robot can help, because most of the time you don't have, or the bank don't have, the time to link the different applications all together, and they rely on humans to take an information from one system to another, and then that's the only reason why it's not been given some automation further than that. It needs to be highly predictable, which means that it needs to be rule-based. You need to know exactly what your robot is going to face so that you can teach the robot what to do. If there's anything unexpected, then the robot will give back to the human and ask for help. So if this is not highly predictable, then your robot will keep on asking for help and it will not be a time saver. Like I said, any project, any process that is prone to error is, of course, and that has already a high predictability, is really a good candidate. We've seen most of the time that when processes are too repetitive and too boring for a human being to do, the human being starts losing attention and then an error can slip in. A robot will never get tired, will never make mistakes if it's really rule-based. And of course, the more volume you have, the better. So if we focus now on those five criteria, and we think about what processes could we see in a bank that could fit those different criteria. Well, an obvious one is account opening and account closing, for example. So this is typically something where you need to create a customer into your systems, where you can have different applications involved. You need to always create the user or your customer name with the same spelling, and sometimes it can be very difficult to keep that. I personally know that, as I have some strange character in my first name, I can see that in many occasions it's been spelled incorrectly. So a robot will be systematic and do all that. Also for the closing, it needs to be in a certain sequence in several applications, so that's a very good process for that. So switching accounts and things like that, so also we've seen processes like that. Credit card applications or PIN reset, this is also a very good candidate, as usually at year end, you will have lots of requests from customers to change the limits or to reset their PIN code because they forgot it. Of course, digitization can help on that by putting into a digital application the ability for the customer itself to change its credit card limit. But until it's there, you can already start using robotics to help you on that and absorb the peak of activities that you can see at a certain point in time in the year. I'm not going to go through all of them, but also in clearing and payment. In KYC, you have lots of applications. And the last bullet point is the example I already gave on competitor price monitoring. You also have in this slide asset servicing and cross-industry examples. As we're currently focusing more on banking, I'm not going to go through each one of them, but you can, of course, read them at your ease afterwards. To give you a real example, and this is actually something that we've implemented within Deloitte Luxembourg, for example, we're using robots ourselves. If you see in gray on the top area of this slide, this is an activity that would normally have been done by an employee. So here it's really making sure that the VAT report can be done. So you would have a human being logging into SAP, taking all the VAT numbers, creating a list in Excel, then checking if each of these VAT numbers on the authority's website is still valid and correct. Then they would actually log the file this and then send finally the report. We've done that also for our own customer base. Sometimes we have changes in addresses of our customers. We have changes in email of the key contacts. We have different informations that are updated on the Registry of Commerce, and we also have a robot can do that. So it goes into SAP, goes to Excel, checks one by one, and if there's any changes, then creates a report. It can even directly change SAP if needed, and it can also warn the different responsibles of the completion of the job via email. So this is something really happening. It can be coded, tested, and implemented quite rapidly. And then allow the employee who was previously in charge of this type of process to do work on something else. I'm going to close this topic with a final slide, which is the potential pitfalls. So here you have five. Of course, there might be more than that, but just things that you need to keep in mind if you want to, as a banker, to start implementing RPA. So first of all, it's that RPA indeed can be applied to multiple areas, but do not start applying it everywhere. There needs to be some research is made. I've given you five criteria for relevant processes to be automated. Do not think that you can apply it to everything, otherwise you're going to be losing effort and not receiving the return on investment you expect. The silver bullet myth, which is that you can improve RPA with RPA anything, if you realize that actually you're only using one application, it's probably that you're not using the application right and that you should be spending more time configuring and improving the application rather than using a robot to use it better. Anarchy, robotics, if it's only done on one process, it's easy. If you start doing that on 10, 15, 20 processes, any changes in the landscape, even though there is some flexibility, some kind of intelligence in the way that the robots can adapt to changing environments, there still needs to be some governance in place to make sure that automation is well managed and doesn't lead to chaos. The euphoria phenomenon is also something that we see at the beginning. Everyone thinks that the RPA is going to solve everything. Well, RPA can certainly, I always talk about band-aids, it can help you fix some issues, it can help you get some quick wins, but it won't be the solutions to any problems you may have in the bank. And finally, the long voice, if you implement an RPA project, make sure that you give enough voice to the team and that you listen to what they're saying, otherwise it will not be successful. So I've completed my section here. I'll be happy to take questions afterwards if we still have a few time. And I'll hand over back to Ronan on the artificial intelligence.
Thank you, Gwen.
So to start this this section, I maybe want to first give a definition of AI, because there is a lot of unclarity in that term. So the way we define it is that it refers to computer systems, software mainly, that are able to perform tasks that normally require human intelligence. And we would apply that in three fields. The first is cognitive insight, so helping people to make better decisions. The second is cognitive engagement, so supporting the engagement between, for example, a customer and a bank. And finally, cognitive automation, so basically the extension of what Gwen just presented, and we will see that a bit more in a minute into detail. So we are used to say that there are five main disciplines in AI. The first is the ability to recognize and understand. So understand and recognize characters, shape, text, voice, for example. Also, then the second is the ability to apply context, and so to see, okay, that word is in that context, so it means that. The third one is to reason and make decisions, so rules, and we will see afterwards the self-learning rules. The fourth one is identify semantics, so understand the meanings behind the word, behind the sentence, behind paragraph. And finally, the ability to learn and improve. So you have rules, but those rules adapt themselves automatically according to experience. So AI is not new. When we did a survey with the ESMA in March this year, we asked people when they heard about AI for the first time. More than 90% of the people say that they heard about AI before 2015. If we ask people, and mainly here it's a focus on banking, where are you in your AI journey? And we see that around 90% of the bank are already in AI projects, busy with AI projects. And when we ask to the people who doesn't start it yet, so the 11%, the main reason is that there is no accountability in the company for that. And when we ask to the 90 remaining percent what are the key challenges they face, we mainly hear the fear of cybercrime, of hacking. Also, some difficulty to understand the technology behind. And for the more mature, the main challenge is the scarcity of talent. And clearly today, we have a big gap between the market of talent in that field and the demand. We also ask to banks, what are the main area of application? And of course, the first one is the customer service. We saw in the press a few months ago the first public use case of customer service with systems that were able to analyze coming emails and coming mail from clients and prepare a response for the operator. The response was not sent directly, but it was prepared. And with that system, you apply for sometimes the ability to recognize characters because physical mail was scanned. Then natural language processing and recognition. Then the ability to apply semantic. And then finally, natural language generation. So it's a very sophisticated system. Clearly, it took more than 1 year to set up. But the gain in terms of efficiency are just huge. Another area of customer service is chatbot. So chatbot is an acronym for chat robot, and we will see a concrete use case in a minute. So you don't have general purpose chatbot. A chatbot is always like for RPA, dedicated to a domain, dedicated to solve one issue. So you might have chatbots just to give you information. I think that the most of you already saw a small window, popping up in the corner of your web browser when you were on an e-commerce website asking you, may I help you? So most of the time, it's a software robot behind. So that's a very common use case. And we have other use cases, as we will see, for example, to open a bank account or fulfill a MiFID questionnaire. Second very common area is back office and operations. So clearly, we have a lot of use cases in document and physical document processing. So we still have some people coming to the branch with paper wire transfer, and we still have many paper-based transactions. So clearly here, having those paper scans automatically recognized and then processed, for example with RPA, is a very common use case. Another one is the approval of credit overdraft. So Gwen talked about robot being able to encode into the system a credit overdraft or a limit extension, for example. But what AI can add is the ability to run an algorithm that can decide if the credit overdraft or the limit extension can be granted, and that algorithm will be able to learn according to the credit default. And finally, we of course have application in the area of financial advisory, fraud detection and risk management, but those are less common. And when we ask people, they see those use cases more in the medium term and long term. But clearly, everybody expects AI and customer service and back office operations to be mainstream in the next 2 years. So let's see a short use case. So that's a project we did a few months ago. So I will just give a word about MiFID. So MiFID is a second directive in that field that aims to increase the customer protection, basically. And one of the key activities is to define what is the risk profile of a client, to understand what kind of assets he can buy or not. And to understand the risk profile of the client, you have to ask several questions. And the way it is solved today, it's mainly sometimes paper-based, but mostly form-based. And you have to fill some forms can be on a website. And clearly, the common issues we have, it's that people don't understand the question. It's painful to fill. And you might have some errors because you have some misunderstanding issue. And on top of that, in terms of customer experience, clearly it's painful. So we look with the team how we could improve that and make it, let's say, more seamless. And we start to explore the chatbots. So chatbots, as we said, has a focus. It has an ability to understand the language. It has the ability to understand some synonyms. But then you need to program the rules that will help him to decide what to do. You also have to learn to the chatbot the specific vocabulary that you need to use. And so we learn to the chatbot the vocabulary of MiFID. And we code the rules that enable him to, if you take, for example, a question, what have you studied? And if you answer, I have a master in finance, the chatbot will automatically adjust your risk profile according to that because you have a better knowledge of financial instruments. And so we developed the chatbot to fulfill a MiFID questionnaire. The consequence is that from a user experience perspective, of course, it doesn't fit all customer segments, but for a good part of the population, a good part of the client, It will provide a much better user experience than having to fill in a paper or having to fill a formula. It saves a lot of time on the bank side. And also, it can be quickly adapted. If you have to change a rule in your MiFID questionnaire, you change it in the bot, and it's automatically adapted everywhere. And as Mark Zuckerberg said, we think as well that at the end, we should message a business just the way you message a friend. And clearly, that's also a main trend in AI today. So I hope that you understand a bit more about robotics, about AI, about open banking. We will open the question in a few seconds. So if you want to ask a question, just use the chat and chat the Deloitte user. And before that, just a word about some conclusions. We saw that technology and open banking are disrupting the industry at a pace that we haven't seen before. And to take that into account, banks have to transform themselves, but also adapt the way they plan and they transform themselves. Meaning that given the pace of change of technology, and also giving the pace of new entrants, it's the end of the 5-year plan, clearly. So people have to do a short-term plan, medium-term plan, decide in which area they want to be the leader, but it's clearly becoming impossible to know what project you will do in 3 years. So that's the first change. And the second change, transformation should be done a different way. Of course, we are talking about agile. Everybody is talking about that since many years, so I won't talk about that. DevOps is another challenge. Everybody is talking about DevOps. Few are doing that in reality. It involves a lot in terms of talent transformation, technology transformation. But something that people doesn't wait enough in their project plan is change management. We are now deploying new technologies, new process every month in the branches, in the teams. And clearly, we have to take into account the ability of the teams to process all those changes. Because if they are not adopters of those changes, they won't be the promoter of those changes towards your client. And clearly we saw that the most successful banks have doubled or tripled the typical ratio invested in change management and adoption in their digital program. So that's what we wanted to say to you today. We hope you find it interesting, and we are now open to questions. I just see a first question, Gwenael, for you on robotics. People are asking if we can have any sense of the cost of such a project or robot.
Well, it's an interesting question. I would say that if you would have asked me this question a year ago, it would have been quite simple. I would have told you that a robot would cost around $10,000 a license per year per robot. That would be the license cost, and most of the time the providers would ask you to take a certain number of robots, so let's say minimum 10. That would be your license cost, so $100K for a robot, plus you have to add on top of that the implementation, so the time you spend with either internal resources or with integrators such as Deloitte. To analyze the process and see how you can test it, code it and test it. But nowadays, the pressure is actually increasing. We have more and more players in the RPA field, and some of them are actually now offering their licenses for free. So you can get RPA for free for some of the providers, Of course, it's only for a limited application, and usually they also have a artificial intelligence and machine learning behind that is being priced. But now the license cost is getting lower, and we have some players that have some very strong and complete solutions for about, let's say, between 1,000 and 2,000 or 3,000 euros. You can have some very strong solutions a year for that, and no limitation on the number.
Yeah, we have further question on robots and also on AI. I will start with maybe a question just for RPA. Do you think it's more an IT driven or more a business driven initiative?
Well, I see a question which you get a lot. I would say it's more a business oriented project, but you definitely need to have the IT on board. So you cannot do those type of projects without having a strong support from IT. We need to then support and do the maintenance like I just explained, but it's mainly process oriented, so you need to have the business people in front of you to really understand what is the low added value task that you can give to a robot and really build those rules. And for that you need to have the business needs to be involved heavily, trust the robot so that they can move on to other tasks while trusting the robot. So definitely business with a strong IT support.
Got another question that I will take. I will read it. So how can we do to enhance robots with AI, and what's the real value and importance? So clearly there is a strong learning curve there. You shouldn't try to do AI integrated with RPA in the first instance. It's important to have your RPA running with rules, getting the technology, and in parallel, that will be clearly an optimization. You can start to add, for example, machine learning. You can start to add natural language generation. But those topics are much more complex and require other kind of skills. What's the real value and importance? That's a matter of business case and people being busy with that task in the bank. We saw at one of our clients very recently very too much people being busy with the processing of cards, processing limit of cards, and so on. And so there was such a potential to automate that in that case, yeah, it's important also to explore AI at the same time, because you can potentially reduce the processing time to not zero, but something close to zero, if you combine the power of robots and AI. Any other question? No, I don't think so, but that's good because it's six. So I thank everybody and our speakers today also for your attendance, for your time. I think that the recording will be posted on the website very soon, and we look forward to have you in our next meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.